But his tax cut and budget policies aren't doing too well. Both programs suffered setbacks in both the House and Senate budget committees. And the Democrats have unveiled their response to the Reagan economic program. Some basic differences emerged this week between the U.S. and West German views of relations with the Soviet Union. And there continues to be concern about the prospect of Red Army intervention in the Polish crisis. Well, you and the terms of the president's setback in the Senate and House budget committees, do you think that his economic program's any real trouble at this point in the Congress?
Well, Martin, look at the background music. As a matter of fact, it looks to me like the Democratic program is more Republican than the Republican one is. So I would say this is temporary.
Jack?
Martin, his tax program has been in trouble all along. And I expect he'll get about 75%, 85% of his budget reductions. But I never have thought he'd get his three-year tax program.
I don't think these setbacks are much at all. In the House, I think they may have the vote to overturn the action of the House committee. In the Senate, what the Senate committee did was trivial and was done for trivial reasons, in fact, and was of no lasting significance, and I agree with you.
In terms of being addressed to the deficit rather than the budget.
And I agree with you that the really striking thing about what's going on now is not that you have an argument, but that the center of argument has been moved so far to the right.
Yeah. I agree that the striking thing is that the Democrats have become the Republicrats and have tried to steal the Reagan's clothing. The center of argument has moved. I would say that it's not only moved to the right, but it's moved to the point where for the next 2 years, probably nothing very relevant to the economic welfare and health of the country is going to happen. It's just the significant problems of the country are off the agenda.
Well, we'll examine that rather extraordinary statement in a moment, Joe. Joe, that's rather a sweeping statement you make, that nothing's going to happen in the next couple of years in the sense that...
I didn't say nothing was going to happen. I think what you have for the next 2 years is a fight between the Republicans and the Democrats over a very, very narrow sphere of budgetary issues. And it doesn't touch any of the really significant issues that have put this country in trouble now, namely the issue of wage prices or the issue of energy, so that all the things that cause for, or the main things that cause for high inflation, slow growth, declining public services, those things are off the agenda for the next 2 years,
well,
and we're going to have this narrow little fight.
Play a significant role in fiscal policy and the state of the economy, that's one thing. Second thing is that there is clearly a Democratic answer, in effect, to the, or an effort to make an answer to the Republican economic program. There is a concern continually voiced on the Democratic side about the so-called social welfare net, an effort to save some of the social programs. You don't think any of that is significant?
I don't think it's an answer. I think it's a holding operation. I don't think it's going to I don't think you're going to have these big social programs put back in, and neither do I think you're going to get the president's tax program. So that whatever chance you had of having the president's program going all the way through and making a radical bite at inflation, I think is now leached out. But the really significant questions, wage price and energy, I think have just been fenced out of this debate.
I think far more important than the wage price question, 10 times more important than the cost of energy, is the general decline of productivity, which I associate more with the low savings ratio in this country. And it seems to me that the Reagan program directly addresses this by cutting taxes, particularly on unearned, so-called unearned income. It seems to me that when if the laws of economics hold at all, if the American people are still responsive to altered incentives, and there's no reason to doubt that they are, then the Reagan program, which is designed to increase the cost of consumption relative to work, or rather leisure relative to work and saving and consumption relative to savings, to make people save more and work harder, is exactly what the country needs.
I was about to say the Democrats have some tax incentives they want to put in the middle of summer, 1st of July under the Democratic program. They would cut back on
and larger than the Republican.
Yeah, larger than the Reagan.
Listen, I'm not as pessimistic as Joe about this. I think the whole thing is just amazing. As we said earlier, the thing has moved to the right. The Democrats are trying to steal much of the Republican program. And then you get into this matter, for instance, the Roskinkowski tax scheme would cut the top brackets, which is one of the very important elements in the matter of supply-side economics, and then it would also grant more to business in the first year, more depreciation allowance.
The Roskinkowski thing has another dimension, which I think is a rather interesting view. They're moving, in effect, the democratic concern for the common man to a democratic concern for the middle-income man.
Right.
Martin, I preached to you for the last weeks that the really needy weren't hurt that much by any of these programs, and it's that middle class that got
hit. Well, I don't accept that. I know you preach it.
Okay, but in fact, Martin, I think there is a direction established. There is a momentum towards some very broad goals now apparently agreed upon by both Democrats and Republicans. I think that's terribly significant.
The difference is a difference of degree now.
That's right.
I think the differences are very, very sharp and very narrow. And nothing that I see on the part of either one of these programs is going to sell cars, for example. And you've got to sell cars to have the economy recover.
What do you mean cars? I don't understand.
Cars. Automobiles.
Oh, cars. That's that Harvard accent.
Here's that New Jersey accent. Automobiles. I just don't see anything there that's going to do it. Moreover, the productivity increase, I think productivity is terribly important. I think, George, you would admit that the productivity gains from this are going to be very, very slow.
Yeah, but what about the accelerated depreciation allowances for business, which are aimed at that very target?
If you're not selling automobiles, you're not going to have big investment.
There are many indications that there may be an enormous increase in the sale of American automobiles.
GM keeps raising the price as
Martin,
they did last
year. Martin, the Japanese have this advantage. That is, their cars are cheaper and their cars are better. Now, that's a pretty good...
You'll hear from a lot of people
about
that.
Well, I'm very sorry to say that. Now, it seems to me that's why I take a very hard-nosed view about protecting the automobile industry. I agree with Joe. You can't revitalize this economy without revitalizing the automobile industry. My God, it's 8.5% of the economy, its products and services. It's 25% of retail sales. You just have to do it. And we ought to face the fact.
May I raise a different statistic?
I don't agree with that.
If you're going to cut back, which is a number you hear most often, Japanese imports to 1.5 million or 1,650,000. You know, you're just not really doing any kind of a significant reduction.
All you're talking about is
250,000.
No, that's not true.
It
was 1.9 million last year, and no one says you have to cut it back to 1.6. You could cut it back to 1.2. Furthermore, Martin, as Joe said, General Motors and these people are raising the prices of their cars, whereas the earnings position of the Japanese car makers have them perfectly positioned to defend or even expand their market share by cutting prices.
Well,
unless there is a physical limit on the imports of Japanese cars, the American automobile industry is going to stay stagnant.
George, would you agree with me, George, that the president so far is indicating, as does Mr. Stockman, I believe, and generally our trade representatives, that they're not that eager to cut back on Japanese imports?
Of course they're not. Look, we all understand that in the best of all possible worlds, everyone would be free trade. But that's not true. If they don't do it, it's going to be legislated by Congress. I guarantee it, Martin.
Well, don't guarantee it.
There are some signs for reasons for optimism, though. Joe found none. But cars are getting older. We haven't sold that many cars in the past 2 or 3 years. And at some point, these automobiles simply must be replaced, willy-nilly. They just have to. They're going to wear out.
I think that's a very important point.
In fact, we got onto this through the root of productivity. I think you're going to have 1 or 2 good years. I don't think it's going to be going to reverse the basic underlying non-competitive character of America's basic industry.
When GM
raises its prices, the union is going to not be able to show wage restraint. When they don't show wage restraint, you have the same cycle that's gotten us into this trouble in the past, and it's going to go on and on. I think President Reagan's program is not in serious trouble, but I don't think it addresses itself to the basics, and now the Democrats are on board the Reagan program.
Well, I'm glad we came back to that. Is his program indeed in serious trouble? You think, then, that despite what happened in the House and Senate budget committees, it is not significant that these differences will be compromised.
The outlook now is just
what
it was before.
You will get, in effect, the Reagan fiscal policies put into effect of the economic program.
You'll get the cutbacks in spending and the Democratic tax.
But Martin, don't leave that long oration by Joe to go unchallenged here.
I just don't necessarily
believe that these intricate analyses apply. Our history in this country is one in which people made these dire predictions and many of them didn't materialize. The automobile industry is an immense part. What is it, 8%
sales products,
George, and it affects so many places. But in fact, number one, the industry, if it went broke or had readjustments, would not be eliminated totally. The fact is that we may indeed make some improvements. Productivity may improve a little bit. There also are many other healthy industries. One of the reasons that this nation has not fallen into the great abyss here is that you've got an airframe industry that's booming, you've got a computer industry. Seems to me that the mood has changed a little here, and you can't discount that. I'm just not that worried that...
Nor would I discount the point that Jack made, which is the pent-up demand. People have kept their cars for a long time. They are practically obsolescent. They must have new cars. And they're going to buy them.
And I want to respond. I'm not saying there's going to be a recession. I don't think there will be a recession. I think defense spending is going to save you from that. But I don't think that the kind of structural change that induces big productivity gains is coming up.
You're talking about now in tax policy. Is that what you mean?
No, in general in the economy. And I think that what happened during the past week was that the Democrats climbed on the Republican bandwagon, and now you don't have what I would call even serious criticism anymore.
Look, the Japanese see our pent-up demand for automobiles. That's why they're planning a 20% increase in capacity in the next 3 years. And I see no reason to believe that they're not going to expand their market share. But can we go back just a minute to the question of who's on whose bandwagon? One of the ironies of what happened to the president in the Senate Budget Committee, where the Republicans have a majority, is that the Republicans for 20 years have finally won the argument just at a time when they want to get off it. That is, they've said the problem is the deficit. And Grassley and Sims, two guys who have 6 years to go before they have to face the voters again, couldn't even give their president that vote because they said we're worried about the deficit. Just at a point when the Republicans are saying it's not the deficit that's the problem, it's more complicated than that.
Interesting point, George, and we'll discuss it in a minute. You have a lot of problems at home, plenty of problems abroad. All week, well, for some weeks now, there's been concern up and down that the Red Army would be sent to intervene in the Polish crisis. That subsides, and then there's the fear occurs again. Brezhnev seemed to cool it a bit when he made that statement in Prague that the Poles could deal with their own crisis themselves, he was assured. And there was some subsidence then in the crisis. Now, it's still indicated by our Secretary of Defense, Caspar Weinberger, who's been abroad meeting with NATO nations, that he does have a concern still of a Soviet intervention, that Soviet forces are still in a position to carry out such an intervention on the Polish frontier. And he made the observation that perhaps the Soviet method of intervention, as he put it, would be to intervene by osmosis, move in units little by little until there had been a considerable force and they were in control. How do you feel this is going to move now?
Well, you can't discount this idea of attempting to have victory without any bloodshed or war. That's been one of their primary objectives throughout all of this. But, Martin, the fact of the matter is it's still very dangerous and probably will be for many more weeks. Most of the people to whom I have talked about this will point out to you that it's quite clear at this point but the Soviets are terribly worried about what will happen around the world and in Poland if they move in, that they are intimidated perhaps more than they've ever been, and they're hesitant to do it. But at the same time, they also point out that the Poles can read this and that they're probably not going to give up their demands to the extent that they would like.
Their concern extends to the whole East European satellite area.
Surely, and so that as the Russians hesitate, the Poles perhaps get a little bolder, and that the thing just isn't going to be resolved for quite a while. It's still dangerous. There's still a great chance they'll move.
Jack?
I would expect a high level of tension going on for the next 60 days, 6 months perhaps, Martin. But I'm optimistic about the business of an actual invasion. I just don't believe it's going to happen. The general strike was called off. That relieved a good deal of the tension at that time. The Brezhnev statement probably will help a little bit. I find the signs reasonably encouraging.
Mm-hmm. A lot of talk again about linkage, both from Haig and from the Secretary of Defense. Linkage to arms control talks, for example. A point that was raised, by the way, by West Germany's Chancellor Schmidt, who, while he was critical of the Soviet Union, and more critical than he has been for a long time, was very, very careful to return, and returned very strongly to his concern for continuation of détente. Do you think that there's any fundamental difference between the American and the European point of view on this?
Well, it depends on what you mean by fundamental. I think clearly the United States is more convinced of the need for linkage because, knowing the United States Senate, they know that linkage is an accomplished fact. That is, you cannot get ratified arms control agreements as long as the Soviet Union is conducting, as it has been since Angola and South Vietnam, a geopolitical assault against this country. Therefore, it's not a theoretical question, it's a practical reality. We have linkage.
Joe?
First, let me say a word about the general condition in Poland, because I think I see it a little bit differently than Hugh and Jack. My impression is that the Russians are very, very much on the offensive there, that they are forcing the pace and pushing it, that while they would like to not have an intervention and cut whatever costs, every time they see the Poles coming back and making accommodation, the Russians tighten the screws. For example, when the general strike ended, it took 4 or 5 days of mobilization and big alarms and shouting and everything else before Brezhnev eased it. And my impression is that before easing it, Brezhnev got a commitment from the Poles that they would apply martial law or restrict strikes. I think that's going to be very, very hard to do. And my impression is that the Russians see the Poles on the run and are pushing it, and pushing it very, very hard, because they see the possibility of forcing a change in Poland without an intervention. In view of that, it's sort of creeping intervention and very, very difficult, I think, to analyze. I really wonder whether the kinds of things the Secretary of Defense has been saying are up to the level of the sophistication of what's happening. And my fear is that he's not only causing the Germans and other Europeans to pull back a little bit from American leadership, but that some of them, anyhow, are beginning not to take us very seriously.
But what did my leader say that you thought was so bad?
Particularly the comment about China, that if the Russians go, that might trigger arms to China. First of all, that raises a whole new other subject that takes your mind off what's really important. Secondly, suppose the Russians don't go. What do we tell the Chinese? Sorry, fellas, it's all off.
Well, this is another of Joe's super sophisticated arguments, and he may or may not be right, but there's another argument.
I don't
think it's
super sophisticated. No. I think it's very straightforward, and I think it's right on target.
Okay, that's fine, but I'm just saying that there are other people, and I don't necessarily take a role in this, but there are other people that have other ideas to whom I've talked here recently, and one of them is it's much more simple than that, that indeed the Soviet Union is intimidated a little bit by the new attitude of Mr. Reagan, of Mr. Haig, and Mr. Weinberger, and though they don't always speak with one voice, nevertheless there is a sense of direction, a sense of more firmness, a sense that we may intimidate our European allies a little to have some rather serious consequences of an invasion, and at least that plays a part of their reluctance at this time. So a little, I would say, a little hope there, maybe.
I don't think the question really should be posed, will there be an invasion? The question is, will solidarity be smashed? And it can be smashed without an invasion if you get the right smashers in the offices in Warsaw. To me, Martin, there was nothing encouraging about Brezhnev's speech in Prague, because they have now thoroughly defined the issue as socialism against anti-socialist elements, and they have come as close as they can to defining solidarity as an anti-socialist, which is a treasonous element in Poland. That draws the lines of conflict so sharply. Can I just offer you a vignette?
You oversimplify there, don't you?
I'm just quoting Brezhnev.
Well, their concern for the impact in the whole Eastern European satellite area has to be a very considerable concern.
Sure, of course.
Does it not?
Look, Martin, if that country starts losing the places where its government has no legitimacy, it will crumble to the gates of Moscow, because the Soviet Union is a hodgepodge of subdued nationality. I understand that, but let me tell you why I think there's still going to be a crisis in Poland. And there's a little incident happened when Walesa went to Rome to visit the Pope. He went south one day to Monte Cassino, where some Poles fought in the battle in the Second World War, and he laid a wreath. Now, the striking thing to me about that is that's the act of a head of state, making national gestures at national symbols. That symbolizes to me the fact that the government of Poland is barely an occupying power now, that all the legitimacy has been drained away, whatever attached to it, from the Communist Party, and that's the crisis in the Polish system.
George, I think that's an enormous overstatement of the symbolic.
I absolutely agree with George. It does seem to me that the Russians have, during the past week, arranged a successful political maneuver.
Well, wait a minute. I thought George said it wasn't going to be successful, that he expects a crisis to come later on.
It will either be by intervention, which I still expect, and if not by intervention, it will be because they get the right Stalinist hacks from the Polish party in power to do their dirty work.
They could always have triggered it at any moment that they chose. Any pretext would serve if they wanted to go that route.
Well, they prefer to have the Poles do it for them. And they have made some big progress, because Solidarity now is on the defensive against the Polish regime. But I can't take this accusation of being super sophisticated.
I agree, a general
toughening of the line did have a good impact and was useful in dealing with the Soviet Union. I think what Secretary Weinberger has now done has been to evoke a number of specific situations, and I think those are not very realistic, and that he's losing the respect of some of the allies.
There's a lot of conflict and irritation among our...
Can I have about 15 seconds for the most important story of the week? Spring in Washington.
By all means, Jack.
I think this time of year, Washington is the most beautiful capital city in the world, not excluding Paris or London. And this is largely owing to the good works of Lady Bird Johnson. You saw to it, I looked up the figures the other day. We have 1,250,000 daffodils blooming in Washington this week, 450,000 tulips, and 250,000 other bulbs. And it is just magnificent.
Well, that's a delight, but would you accept, since it's the appropriate season, an assist from the Japanese down at the tidal place?
A very fine assist from the Japanese. Between the Japanese and Lady Bird, we've got a lovely, lovely city right now.
Even the Scrooge in this corner feels good about that.
Joe,
the looks of the city.
Last word, Joe. Thank you, gentlemen.